popular, but it leads to a land of promise.
Do you think you can tell me what to do? Do you think you can tell me what to say?
He looked at us and turned and walked back through the valley.
There is probably no other unknown creature that arouses more curiosity than the Bigfoot or Sasquatch. Yes, there is the Loch Ness Monster, the Chupacabra, and other great beasts of lore, but the Bigfoot remains the most compelling as it pulls us towards ourselves, shadowing the unknown X factor of our very origins. The case files contain thousands of reported sightings, yet no actual specimen has ever been found. Hundreds of photographs exist, but the creature has not yet been identified. Still, the clues accumulate year after year. In the words of one Bigfoot investigator, it is an extremely complex phenomenon, with no starting point and no geographical limits. If this creature does exist, then it is most certainly a relative of man. Descriptions of the ape-like creature do not vary dramatically with credible sightings. The creature is anywhere from 6 to 10 feet tall, 300 to 1,000 pounds, and walks upright on two legs. Hair covers almost all of its body and ranges in color from black to silvery white, with the predominant color being brown or reddish brown. The creature is often reported to have a flat face and nose, a receding, sloped forehead with a prominent brow ridge, and a cone-shaped head, which sits on broad shoulders with no apparent neck. Its proportions are roughly those of a human being, except for its long, dangling arms. Bigfoot draws its name from the enormous footprints it leaves behind, many as long as 2 feet by 8 inches wide. The length of stride varies, but the distance is usually close to 4 feet between prints. There have been group sightings, 2 adults and 1 or more juveniles. The creature appears to be largely nocturnal. Species unknown at this time. When gorillas were first seen by white men early in the last century, the reaction to this discovery was one of shock and astonishment. Native stories of such creatures were well known, but were viewed as mere folklore and mythology by the scientific community. Prior to this paleontological milestone, man had the idea that he had more or less discovered everything there was to discover about ourselves. Bigfoot, also known in North America as the Sasquatch or the Oma. Was the Sasquatch here before the Indians? Thousands of Indian locations are named after the Bas of the mountain, or the Wild Man, as the Bigfoot was originally called by the Amerindians. Indian cultures generally regard the Wild Man with the greatest respect. He is viewed as a special kind of being, perhaps because of his seemingly close relationship to humans. Many Indian elders regard him as standing on the border between animal and human consciousness, giving him a supernatural kind of power. But as special as he may be, there is no tribe that suggests that he is anything other than a physical being, living in the same physical dimensions as humans and other animals. He eats, he sleeps, gathers, and communicates with family members. Wild man or Sasquatch attributes from numerous reports. The smell of a Sasquatch far exceeds that of a bear or other mammals. Many cases report an intolerable stench when a Bigfoot is in the area. They vocalize in terrifyingly high-pitched scream-like mannerisms. Many recordings have surfaced in recent years. They knock trees, possibly to communicate with each other over long distances. They throw rocks and boulders. There are many reported cases where a Bigfoot throws rocks at campers, even boulders from the hilltops above if disturbed. They live in family units. Many cases report the sighting of not one but two or more individuals at a time, often with young in tow. They wash their food. In 1924, Albert Osman was abducted by a Bigfoot, then held captive by a family unit. He noted, among other things, that the female Bigfoot washed and stacked leaves and vegetation. This behavior has been reported multiple times in the last 100 years. They may have developed a language. Many reports tell of a whinnying or gurgling whistle sound associated with their possible speech patterns. The creature has many names and is known by cultures all over the globe. Almas, Asia. Bigwas, BC, has lay community. Jinsung, Asia. Kakundukari, Africa. Momo, North America. Ngoi Rung, Asia. Nukluk, North America. Nyalmo, Asia. Oma, North America. Orang Pendak, Oceania. Sasquatch, North America. Tano Giant, Africa. Te Ima, Asia. Ukumar, Latin America. Yerin, Asia. Yeti, Asia. Yowie, Australia. It seems that the wild man may indeed be of a varied and widespread clan, encompassing every continent of the world. They all have one very distinct trait in common: an exceptionally big human-like foot. But in recent years, the enigma of the Bigfoot has taken another leap. The Bigfoot has dermal ridges. A friction ridge is a raised portion of the epidermis on the palm and fingers of the hand, or the sole and toes of the foot. They consist of one or more connected ridge units of friction ridge skin. These ridges are also known as dermal ridges. The three basic patterns of dermal ridges are the arc, loop, and whorl. Many Bigfoot castings clearly show dermal ridges, not unlike those found in human beings. If the Bigfoot phenomena is a prank or a hoax, it is one of the greatest hoaxes of all time. The best prints on record were found in very, very remote places. To leave these prints and artificially create dermal ridges would be extremely difficult, to say the least. And let us not take lightly that Gigantopithecus was indeed a very real creature. Gigantopithecus is an extinct genus of ape that existed from roughly 1 million years to as recently as 300,000 years ago in what is now China, India, and Vietnam, placing Gigantopithecus in the same time frame and geographical location as several hominid species. The fossil record suggests that Gigantopithecus were the largest apes that ever lived, standing up to 10 feet and weighing up to 1,200 pounds, making the species 2 to 3 times heavier than modern gorillas and nearly 5 times heavier than the orangutan, its closest living relative. Evidence of a separate species, Gigantopithecus gigantus, has been found in northern India and China. Another genus, Gigantopithecus blackeye, fossils of teeth and mandibles have been found in cave sites in Southeast Asia. Recent research using high-precision dating methods has shown that after existing for approximately 1 million years, Gigantopithecus blacki died out merely 100,000 years ago. This means that it coexisted with modern humans, Homo sapiens, for thousands of years, and with the most immediate ancestors of Homo sapiens before that. Many cryptozoologists believe that Gigantopithecines are the legendary primates known in various geographic locations as the Bigfoot, the Yowie, the Yeren, the Yeti. But these claims are not considered credible by the scientific community. Although the wild man has been most frequently seen in the Pacific Northwest, sightings are by no means limited to that area. They are in fact worldwide and remarkably consistent from case to case with regards to many attributes and mannerisms reported by the eyewitnesses involved. Our search for this film brings us to the great state of Kentucky, the Bluegrass State, and the home of the Kentucky Derby. Throughout the last 100 years, there have been many wild man sightings in Kentucky. May, 1894, Deep Creek. 5 men encounter man-beast, which raided farms and was trapped to a cave. February, 1959, Covington. Motorists saw a large, hairy, two-legged creature on a bridge. In the 1960s, there were many sightings around the Kentucky Lake area. In one instance, a family reported to a local newspaper that they were fishing and saw a creature that walked like a man and drank from the lake using his hands. June 1962, Trimble County. 2 men saw a black, hairy, 6-foot creature attacking their dogs. Other activity was reported in the area. July 1962, Mount Vernon. 4 young people encountered a Sasquatch while in their parked car. The creature growled ferociously, scaring them into hysterics. June 1968, Murray. Doctor reports seeing a Sasquatch on the road. In the 70s, many sightings were reported from Boone County, from farmers waking up from frightened livestock. Spring 1976, near Pembroke. 5 witnesses to 3 sightings. 6-foot-tall creature, huge round shoulders, glowing green eyes, seen near remote houses at night. January 1977, Simpson County. Policeman sees Bigfoot crossing the road at night. Other sightings in the area. August 1978, near Owensboro. Several men corner a Sasquatch beside a pond, shoot it with pistols from 10 feet. It fled into the woods, leaving no trace of blood. August 1978, near Owensboro. Multiple witnesses see a man fire 3 .45 caliber bullets into a Bigfoot's chest from 45 feet away. It ran into the forest, never to be heard or seen again. October 1980, Maysville. An elderly man and woman see a white Sasquatch from their porch. Oddly enough, giant skeletons have been found in Kentucky. At Mammoth Cave, the skeleton of an 8-foot-tall giant was found along with a younger adolescent in 1811. In 1876, the New York Times ran an article that referred to the remains of 3 8-foot giants found in the state. In 1965, landowner Kenneth White was building cattle stalls when under a ledge he found a perfectly preserved skeleton, measuring 8 foot, 9 inches in length. He states that the arms were extremely long and the hands were very large. The skull was 30 inches in circumference. The eye and nose sockets were slits rather than cavities, and the area where the jawbone hinges to the skull was solid bone. Over the last 200 years or more, Bigfoot sightings, as well as other anomalous phenomena, have been reported at a place called Panther Rock in Anderson County. The following is from a letter found in the Kentucky Library, dated 1840. It was on a cold night in the Blue Hills of Kentucky. We felt a presence that was undeniable in this place. Where moonshiners and trappers roam, long after the Indians were gone, we heard the scream of the wild man. Indeed, we knew we were trespassers in his world now. There are no human conveniences, no sheriff or law to call upon, just the wilderness in its perfect and unyielding state. The Amerindians say he was here long, long before them, and long before any white man came to this valley. We heard that scream, that unearthly, deafening, piercing scream, that unequivocally let us know that this was not our domain, and that all the progress man has made meant absolutely nothing in this place. In April, the reality team descended upon the outskirts of Anderson County. Their leader was Philip Spencer, a 30-year veteran of the paranormal and former resident of Anderson County. He returns to his early roots, to the area where he has documented hundreds of cases and spent much of his life. Many paranormal events have occurred here in Anderson County, also known to residents as the Fraser Land. Many of these events are hard to explain in the rational cold light of day. Sightings of Bigfoot, strange lights, and last but not least, huge black cats. Philip Spencer recounts his own personal, terrifying experience with Bigfoot.
Many years ago, my friend and I were riding down the road that parallels this valley. And this is the valley where Salt River runs into Taylorsville Lake. It was late at night. We used to like to ride along, and we would take a large spotlight and shine through the valleys and just look at the animals, the deer specifically. And late one night, we were cruising down the road. I was a passenger holding the light up and over the rooftop, and I would shine it through this valley. As we were riding along, we came to this area, and we were looking at the deer back in the field behind me. And we noticed something as I took the light and would sweep it through the valley looking at the deer. We spotted these eyes. And these eyes were different. They were up higher than the deer. And we stopped and we backed up and we looked again with the light. And down in the corner of this field is where we saw the creature. At first it was just standing among the deer. But then, when I hit it with the light, it looked at us. It turned and walked back through the valley. It walked in like a lumbering gait. It wasn't running, wasn't in a rush. It was just moving away at a fair pace. Twice as it moved back through this valley, it would look over its shoulder when it was walking, and it would just turn its head and look back, turn its head and keep walking. We watched it as it stepped over something, possibly a log, a tall log or a fence back here. But it stepped high, but it never broke its stride. We watched as it turned basically into a shadow. We watched as it moved back through this field. We thought very hard about what could that have been. And from the height compared to the height of the deer eyes or this creature's eyes, from what this shadow looked like, the bulk, the stride, we were absolutely convinced that we had seen Bigfoot in this field. A story from the Fraser Man. I'm standing within the Fraser land. Behind me is the Salt River and the old JTS Brown Distillery. A few miles from here, a boy and girl went for a walk in the afternoon. They had done this many times before, but this time would be very different. As they turned a corner, they saw a large, hairy creature sitting on a log. They said that it was taller sitting than they were standing. It changed them forever. They ran. The family actually left the home a short time later. Once again, within the Fraser land, we have a creature that is without doubt Bigfoot.
This Bigfoot experience was so traumatic that children refuse to be interviewed and are terrified to return to the area to this day.
Along the wilderness road they come. Behind them, the struggles of the Revolutionary War. Before them, the conquest of the wilderness. The journey is long and arduous, but it leads to a land of promise. Day after day, the party follows the unfamiliar trail.
There is probably no other unknown creature that arouses more curiosity than the Bigfoot or Sasquatch. Yes, there is the Loch Ness Monster, the Chupacabra, and other great beasts of lore, but the Bigfoot remains the most compelling as it pulls us towards ourselves, shadowing the unknown X factor of our very origins.
I'm standing at this beautiful waterfall along an area known as Gilbert's Creek, which is along the Kentucky River in Anderson County. Surrounded by these beautiful hills and trees and so forth. Many years ago, my friend was hiking up in this area above these tree lines. He had his dog with him. They had many years of outdoor experience. As he walked into a field up above, his dog alerted and looked up. About that time, a deer came out of the side of the woods and ran across the field. He then looked to the right, the upper right corner, and saw something turn. As he looked, he realized it was a large black cat, but not just your normal, what you would consider to be a black cat. Its stomach was enlarged. It ran very close to the ground. His tail was curled under. He said it was a very strange thing to see. He watched as it moved out of sight. His dog just kept looking. So approximately 500 yards from where I'm standing, two men were coming down the road at Gilbert's Creek one night. They were in a small sports car. They came around a curve on the rock road, and what they saw affected them for many years. They witnessed an animal walk off the side of the hill on its back legs. 5 to 6 feet tall, a wolf-like creature with an extended stomach. They watched as he crossed the road and vanished into a field. So here we are, all this beauty and serenity, these hillsides of Kentucky. But up in these hillsides, there lurks rather strange animals. Here in Anderson County, a man who could see his cornfield from his backyard, not once, but on several occasions, watched as what he clearly stated was this Bigfoot creature walking through his cornfield. He could see the creature above the corn. He had no doubt what he saw was a Bigfoot.
A man who lives on a large roaming property deep in the heart of the Fraser Land has had numerous strange occurrences over the years. He has never publicly spoken of the many strange things he has seen and heard until now. The reality team were offered exclusive access to this story and amazing sightings. His voice and appearance have been changed at his request.
Yes, I was going to spend the night on the land that I was in the process of buying. And I brought a little bedroll and some other paraphernalia, camping paraphernalia. Got here a little before dark, several hundred yards from this exact spot. And built a little fire and prepared to spend the evening. I believe I had some campfire coffee and things of that nature. It got dark and you could no longer see anything beyond maybe 20 feet. I heard something large moving through the brush about 60 to 70 yards from where I was bedded down. And I first said, well, maybe there is a deer moving through there, but it made a sound that was unlike a deer would make, in that it made a big footprint. And by big footprint, I mean that it placed its weight down upon branches of a large diameter and crushed them as it moved through the brush. A deer will not do that. The next day, or possibly 2 days later, walked back here to look at the area, and there were many trees very similar to the one that is to my left. I don't know if you see the tree here, this tree. And there were trees in a large area about that, some slightly bigger than that, but most of them about that size, broken off level at about 7 feet in the air, just about a foot above my head. And I found it very unusual. It was a large area, probably of irregular shape, and probably encompassed 50 trees.
When you say you heard a disturbance the night before, was there a storm? Was there anything that something natural happened to hurt these trees?
No, that was the thing that made me come so quickly to see what the source of the disturbance was, and it was a thrashing sound, as you would hear from that great a distance, and I could just tell that there was a lot of movement in the brush. I heard a large ruckus in the yard. I had three pretty good sized dogs, about two-thirds grown. They were between 50 and 60 pounds. And they were fighting with something east of my residence in an open field. And I went out the door with the light to see if I could see what was happening, and I could see them running in and doing battle with something significantly larger than them. And I have no real, it was at the edge of my light. I could see the dogs, I could see their backs to me, and I could see this broadside view of this large animal that looked to me to have a low-hanging belly, was much longer than the dogs, and the dogs would rush in at the creature, whatever it was, and I would hear one yelp and go backwards, and all three of them would go backwards when that happened, and then they would attack it again, and that repeated, and they moved away from me and got out of the edge of my darkness, or out of the edge of my light into the darkness, and I could still see the, or hear the event taking place, but I couldn't see it. Not wanting to go out there, I didn't want to risk injury to the dogs, so I went in the house. The next day, I went out to check the dogs. Two of the dogs were badly mauled. Their faces and heads were scratched and with deep scratches. And one of the dogs was missing, had been carried off. That was my conclusion. Whether or not that was accurate, I don't know, but that was all I could conclude with what I'd seen.
You never saw the dog again?
Never saw the dog again.
As time has gone on, you've lived here. As you've told us, you've had many extremely interesting events. But perhaps one of the most interesting is what is now known as the Fraser Sound. And you have recorded it. It is available. And if you would, just go over your interaction with this sound over the years.
I probably first started hearing the sound about 10 years ago. I never did think too much of it because there have always been sounds out here. But I started to hear it on a regular basis. And I heard it on a regular pathway. And when I listened to it, I said, well, it must be a deer. And then the more I thought, the more I came to the conclusion it's not a deer. I've never heard a deer make a sound like that. And as I said, I've heard deer and watched them and observed them for over 50 years. And at that time, at that point, I established that it was following a definite track. And I started noticing that the sound was always heard right at dark or afterwards. And I have heard the sound only when it was about dark. I can't recall the term for such animals. I think they're referred to as crepuscular or something along that line that primarily come out at darkness. The animal or creature or whatever we can call it moves through areas that I can barely walk through with a relatively great amount of speed. At that point when I started becoming concerned that it wasn't a deer, I started to listen to it closely. I noticed several things about the sound. The sound moved with what I considered great rapidity through extremely dense brush. I have walked the brush myself up the creek bottom. It covered a distance of several hundred yards through dense brush in 3 to 10, maybe 12 minutes max. That's extremely fast. It often got in close proximity to the house or wherever I happened to be. And it had some unusual, I never did hear any footfalls. I listened intently for footfalls. I could not hear them. I couldn't tell if it was bipedal or quadruped. I didn't know what it was. I didn't know if it was on the ground or airborne, but I could hear the sound, and the sound was exactly the sound that I recorded that night, that it was in close proximity to the house. It had some very, very unusual characteristics, and they started to concern me. And the characteristic that concerned me the most was that when I was in the woods and it was traveling through the woods, it approached me. And I have never in all these years that I've been in the woods had any animal in this part of my travels approach me in any way. All animals flee from humans in the woods, and that's been my experience. That might vary in other places, but here, that is the case. And on more than one occasion, two that I can remember very well, it approached me to within 30 to 40 feet, and it was in the darkness, and that started to concern me. I never really felt great amount of fear, but I had some concern in that the dogs that normally always accompany me in a nocturnal walk stayed at a distance of probably approaching 200 to 300 feet and wouldn't come to me when I called them when the sound was close by. That did concern me.
We're in an area with a rock fence, and you have said that you came up in here and you found these rock structures. Tell us a little bit about what you found up in this area.
Well, the things that I have found in this area, this is one. This is a large structure that I first attributed to being nothing more than a pile of rocks that someone maybe stockpiled to clean up the area, the land here, to make the land tillable. Then in looking at the land, I readily recognized that this land will never be tillable, so no one was stacking rock for that purpose. The rock fences here have been completed for, I cannot estimate, I would say approaching 300 years or more, and these rock piles would not have been placed so far from the rock fences if they were placed for use in the fences. And the fences were completed, and some of them are now in ruins, and some of them are still perfect.
You came across a very unusual track, a foot track on this property.
Yes.
A very large track. Would you give us some insight into that track that you found?
Yes, it was in the midst of a terrible drought. And I had heard that sound that was referred to earlier as the Fraser sound moving through the creek bed in close proximity to my house. Hearing it moving through that creek bed, I said, well, if there's any chance of it leaving a trail, it would be in the creek bed. And it was in very close time to that time that I recorded the sound, which made my interest at an extremely high level. So I went out and looked very closely up and down that creek bottom, which was admittedly dry, but it was the most moist area in that area. And I found what looked to be a large one single track where a foot had appeared to have slid or moved sideways because of the green moss and it was of the foot was of a, it appeared to be of a human shape, but it was extremely large. My measurements, and they were crude because I couldn't see a clear outline of the footprint. It was in hard mud, but mud with moss on it. It was in a proximity of 17 inches.
You have mentioned that back in this area, there's a circle. This circle has some unusual qualities. Please tell us about this circle.
Yeah, I used to walk in this area in the dead of winter, because right now we're about on the outer limits of the time with which you can move through here. The foliage is, as you can see, starting to appear on the bushes. You can't see where you're walking, and the briars and such are so dense that you literally have to crawl. So I was traveling in the winter, and it was it's approximately 100 yards over to my left shoulder, and it is an area that is surrounded by trees, primarily cedars, and they're fairly dense, about like here. But this is an area that is nothing but grass, about 30 feet in diameter, and not a sign of a tree anywhere in it. It is simply grass, and it has been that way as long as I can remember.
With the owner's permission, the reality team spend the night in the dark woods. They are warned that their safety is their own responsibility, an understandable warning but disconcerting for the crew members. Nevertheless, they set up and prepare for the night, deep in the heart of the Fraser Land. Shortly after dusk, the crew knows they are not alone.
Semi-wet.
Two team members go deep within the woods and encounter an undeniable presence in the forest. The team moves deeper into the brush in an attempt to flush out the creature. The team becomes surrounded by strange activity.
This is very, very strange. It's a feeling. You can feel whatever this is. We've all had this feeling.
The team not only feels they are being watched, they begin to feel hunted.
Moved.
The team encounters the presence in close proximity.
Area. got movement to our left. The dogs all around us are starting to bark.
So what did you all see? What happened?
We were just tracking all the way down there. It came to us.
It's f***ing with us. It's f***ing with us.
Man, did you hear that? Did you hear what they just said?
Yeah.
No. We've heard several noises, but it's hard to say exactly what they are. But those two noises were done by something heavy. That was a big limb that broke and ran down this path. It was like something thudded its foot and
it
went.
It moves like a ghost.
Two stones knocked together, dogs bark. Then a similar sound, way over on the other side, clack, dogs bark.
There's multiple events going on here. I think there's multiple events going on.
An area like this, you know, it doesn't have a definition. This place is ancient. This place is older than time itself. And the stuff that people experience here defies any description or perception or understanding. It doesn't have a beginning or an end. It just is.
We've heard numerous sounds. Some could be natural, some we don't know. Two of the crew members went down into the wooded area. They could hear and tell that something was moving around them. It moved quickly. It came back up into this area quickly. It doesn't make sense unless you think of it as part of these woods. There's something moving in these woods. It's unlike anything else. But whatever this is, it moves through these woods in almost a liquid form.
Exactly.
It moves through.
It's like air.
It's like air. But this is just what the witness said. This is how he described that movement more than once.
Once again, the team can feel a presence approaching them. Suddenly, strange orbs of light begin to appear in the forest.
There's a pop over there. Then there's a pop over there, and then I see that light right there. It's coming and going, but it's there.
It's just like a light back in the woods, but it moves. Look now, it's dim. Look how dim it is now.
It's not there now, is it, Matt?
I'm still seeing it. I see it too. It's still right there. Look. It's brighter. Look how bright it's getting. Look at that. What is it?
It's getting brighter, Philip.
Yes.
The light from the road, the blue light. It's getting brighter and brighter and brighter. Is our shape and our elemental form reappearing. It's there. It's faint, but it's still there, and I can clearly see it right there. As soon as that thing started to come back around, and we saw a light, a pinpoint light, in one, two, and three places, and it moved at least 20 feet in our line of sight. And about that time, we saw a little figure pop out and pop back in. Didn't see arms and legs.
No.
It's just a black thing.
Just a black blur that came out and went back in. What was strange about it was at the same time we saw the lights in the same area as the lights.
Maybe it was just a firefly, but it seemed big. But I know what the is that?
What is it? Dude, look through here. Look through there, right now.
Through there.
What is it? Is it something moving?
It's a light.
Yeah. Yeah. See? That's exactly right. You can't see it, but the camera picks it up.
Holy
shit. Let me see.
Look at that.
What is that?
I don't know.
Oh.
Here, back up.
Look at that. There's absolutely nothing there without the...
That's right. That's right.
Nothing.
You guys still there?
You guys need to go check that out.
Phillip. Whoa, I'm gonna walk over there.
Ross, look at that. What is that? What is this? There's some heat source over there.
Can you zoom in on it?
No, okay.
Let's go up there.
Come on.
What a night. I mean, just an amazing place. An amazing forest, the trees, the wind, the creaking, and just everything that happened within just a few hours after the sun went down.
It was, I mean, what can you say? You can spend half your life out in the woods trying to listen and see things that just are strange in the night. We were doing it within 30 minutes. We heard sounds after
right away when we came out.
Right
too.
Away.
Yeah.
Over to the left, to the right.
Right.
And then as you two journeyed deeper into the area,
right.
It was like something was flushed up.
Right. Right.
And it came up to where we were and
right.
We heard it.
Right. And anytime we were in a location where nothing was going on, we come back and you guys had gone through something and vice versa.
Exactly. Like you two would go into the woods and then the next thing you know, Matt and I, we see a shadow move across that light. We saw that.
Yeah.
What was it?
You know, it's weird, and with those kinds of shadows, they're nondescript. You can't see clearly defined features, but there is no question that it's there. It's a void. It's black.
Right.
It moves. It comes across.
Right.
It blocks out light and foliage behind it.
It moved across that light between us and the light.
What about those sounds, the ones that others have heard, that we've heard that they happen around sunset? That, yeah!
Exactly.
We heard that, I think, twice. Right.
Twice.
Right.
And the dogs
and
alerted.
And the dogs went crazy. I mean, echoing all throughout the forest.
Right.
Dogs here on either side of, you know, the area.
Yeah, and that's us as a group, too.
Right.
When we went down into the woods and left you two poor people behind to be attacked, we went down quite a way. We stopped a lot on the way, but as we were going down, we sort of knew that something was in the woods at the side of us.
Right.
Almost as if it knew we were there and it was watching. And of course,
you could feel it.
You could feel it. Well, also you could hear it. I closed my eyes every now and then so that I could pick the sound up, know where it is.
Right.
And of course, it was following our footsteps.
Mm-hmm.
Our footfalls.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah.
Point
oh yeah.
Right. Every time we stopped, it did.
Right.
And we knew it was in front of us. It started making dogs bark in the distance. It was that far away. And that's one of the unusual things about this, the speed this thing moved.
That's right. And did you see it move across before it flanked us?
Totally.
Okay.
It moved, some shadow moved across.
Right. Before. Right. Way down at the bottom. Right. Right. And it, tell me if I remember this right. Because, you know, when whatever it is, the presence is there, it's just unmistakable that you can feel it. But I could feel the thing moving as if it was air or something, all the, I mean, such a distance, and then you recognize that it was behind us.
Yes.
In no time.
The really interesting thing for me is I came to this, as you all know, as a total skeptic.
Right.
You know, I came to this, I don't believe, I'm not a Bigfoot chaser, I'm not a ghost hunter, I'm not any of these things, I'm a skeptic.
Right, and that's why you were specifically chosen for the mission.
Absolutely. And I go in there, and I am the one of those who starts seeing, turns the corner and sees a shadow go past. Where I heard the noise.
Right, right.
You know?
And you're the team debunker.
I'm the debunker.
That's right. And the dogs. The dog correlation to when we would feel, you know, whatever that presence
and
is.
And the stones.
And the stones.
Yes, you know?
Two clacks, distinct. Two stones together. Maybe they weren't stones, but they sounded like stones. Clack reaction. A clack over here, same sound over on the other side of where we are. Dogs react, feel the presence. Amazing, you know.
And there was the other piece where we were a bit more out in the clearing back with the guys, and we all saw the lights in the clearing.
That's right.
And then
that's
me and you shoot over there, let's see what it is, let's go and find out, let's get closer to this thing. And what do we see? This black shape come out and
that's
go
right.
back into the trees.
That's right.
This amorphous shape.
Right, right. Amorphous. Key word,
yes.
Amorphous. You know, a lot of people have an interpretation or an expectation of what, you know, ghosts and entities and so forth look like. You don't know until you've experienced that. There is no definition. There is no standard. There is no box to put it in.
Mm.
Clearly.
My imagination didn't fill in and didn't make a face in
not
that
at all.
Cloud at
not
all.
Not at all.
I didn't know, all I saw was an amorphous shape. I didn't say, here's the shoulders, here's the head, and create the whole thing.
Right.
Some evolutionary instinct.
Right.
I just went, there's a shape came out, and the shape went back in.
And above
light, below that light.
Yeah, amazing. And above and beyond that, we've got lights on either side, one blue light, one kind of an orange light. According to our research and the property owner, there's no houses on either side. They were fixed lights, but one of them I saw move at least a certain distance. Maybe that was me running up on it. I'm pretty sure. I kept that in mind the whole time, and I noticed it here, and then I noticed it there, and I noticed it there. Lights can be tricky, especially pinpoint lights, no doubt. But let's not discount that steam, white, oval, elliptical thing that was off the ground that we all saw.
Yes.
And it
yes.
got brighter at times. It never got bright as if it was a light being turned on. But perhaps that's just not, you know, that's not a realistic expectation in any way.
Right.
But we all saw that, and we saw it for a long time. Almost to the point where we got bored with it.
In the middle of nowhere.
Yeah.
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 In
up
the
off the ground
right.
to top it off, you know?
As we seem to perceive this thing, or even to just let it go a little bit,
right.
something else would happen.
Right.
It was almost like
right.
quantum physics. We were almost
right.
as if we were, if we perceived that particle, it
right.
would cause a reaction.
Yeah, very interesting.
And lights, particles, amorphous shapes, etc. All of this may merge at some point. Who knows?
I mean, to go out to a place that we've never been, that has a history, and experience multiple things, it just says volumes. You know, it really does. What we should do is move to the Panther Rock,
definitely.
And really, you know, get in there and explore that area, and see what we can experience.
And tonight we take guns.
Cold steel is the recommendation.
That's right.
But hey, you know, we are in the middle of nowhere. This is the wilderness. This place has been here before any human being ever stepped foot here, and you can feel that, and you know that when you're out there
yes.
in this place.
There was a lot of fear factor last night.
Absolutely. Shall we?
Let's do it.
Along the wilderness road they come. Behind them, the struggles of the Revolutionary War. Before them, the conquest of a wilderness. The journey is long and arduous, but it leads to a land of promise. Day after day, the party follows the unfamiliar trail.
The team decides to visit the Kentucky Library in the hopes of finding more history of paranormal activity in Anderson County.
Look at this book that the librarian gave me. It's called Panther Rock. Look at this. This is amazing.
This book I'm familiar with. It was written in 1931 by Errol Bond Burr.
Fantastic.
It is a true glimpse into the history of Panther Rock and Anderson County. This book tells of how the settlers came in, their struggles, their loves, their romances.
It's a real piece of history.
It is. You're holding a real glimpse, a snapshot of a moment in time in Anderson County. This is a real treasure.
It is. It really is.
Holding in my hands a document like this is terrific.
It's fantastic.
It tells so much of the area. This is possibly the only copy.
It's 70, more than 70 years old now.
But this mentions mysterious things also. But there's something that we need to do.
What's that?
We need to travel to the gravesite of Daniel Boone.
Daniel Boone. Daniel Boone's from Kentucky.
Daniel Boone told a tale, a story, about killing a 10-foot hairy creature that he called a yahoo.
You're kidding.
In this book, they talk of the dark and bloody ground, old Kentuck.
Right.
Let's go see some history. Let's visit Daniel Boone's grave.
Let's go.
And so the team set off in search of Daniel Boone's grave. Franklin County, 1795, taken from portions of Woodford, Mercer, and Shelby counties. Kentucky had become a state 3 years earlier with Frankfort as capital. 1792. First meeting of the legislature's second session met here in 1793. Frankfort made county seat 1795, named for Benjamin Franklin, of course, one of the great leaders for independence and the creation of the United States. It's amazing stuff.
Benjamin Franklin was a very famous man.
Yeah.
But on that distant hillside,
right over here,
lies another very famous man. There lies the gravesite of Daniel Boone.
Yeah.
Learned of a cave area called by the Amerindians Yeho, which perhaps could be the precursor to the Yahoo Falls, now so famous to the state. The very place where Daniel Boone, the great frontiersman, claimed to have shot and killed a 10-foot hairy man called a Yahoo.
Oh,
here we are at Daniel Boone's grave, born in 1734, died 1820, entered Basin, Kentucky 1767. Just a great man, a great explorer, and we have an opportunity to be here at his gravesite in this great state.
He's a true legend within the state. His story of killing the great, hairy, tall, wild man of the mountains, him referring to it as a Yahoo. There's even references to be found, Native American references, of an Ahu. Ahu.
I believe that's what that was initially called. Yahoo.
Exactly, Ahu.
Right, and that's it. And somehow along the way, in history, it's been named Yahoo.
Exactly. Whether it was just like other interpretations, perhaps a simpler way to spell something, or just the way the people in the area would speak the language and make the words suitable for their dialects. But what we have here is the marker of a great legend and a great man. He came to this country, he explored it, and along the way, he said he encountered a 10-foot hairy creature and that he killed it. And those tales were told around campfires for many years, and even today, they are still told. So here we are once again, just a distance from the Fraser land, at the grave of Daniel Boone, the man who allegedly killed a 10-foot hairy wild man.
Yeah.
The Yahoo.
Another interesting thing, just in general in the great state of Kentucky, there's just innumerable caves, Mammoth Cave being the most notable. According to record, there were three or four mummified giants, skeletal remains, 7.5 to 8 feet tall. What did you hear about that?
In a sense, this relates to several very hot topics over the years concerning giants found underground. It was even the case where a bone, a femur, was supposedly on display for others to see. The underground limestone cave systems in Kentucky are enormous. Mammoth Cave, approximately 350 miles of underground tunnel.
350 miles.
And that's just one cave. System, of course, that's a cave system, but perhaps, just perhaps, it's more than a cave system. Perhaps it's a way for something that doesn't want to be seen to move from one area to the next.
And it's another interesting fact, and that is a fact in the sense that there's so much Native American activity and folklore here, and that so many of these different structures and rock groupings and walls emulate that of South America near the cenotes and other Incan and Mayan civilizations, all centered around the cave systems or the underworld.
The underworld,
the
exactly.
Other side to life and death.
And remember, we are at the dark and bloody grave.
So here we are at the banks of the Salt River in Anderson County, a good a place as any to talk about just the great history, you know, of the area and sightings over a great period of time.
Exactly.
For example, just at the library, we found out that the Chickasaw Indians, the Shawnee Indians, the Yuki, and the Cherokee, among others, are native to the state. And we found an amazing list of sightings dating back to 1894 and after.
And this is just a brief list.
It is.
A brief list, but they're all interesting and just shows from one end of the state to the other how many reports there are. And as we said, this is just a brief listing.
For example, May 1894, Deep Creek, not exactly here, but close. Five men encounter man-beast, which raided farms and was tracked to a cave.
February 1959, Covington. Motorists saw a large, hairy, two-legged creature on a bridge. Always we seem to have these sightings where they cross roads, bridges, riverbanks.
And water.
Go to 62, Trimble County. Two men saw a black six-foot creature attacking his dogs. Have we heard that not before?
We have.
Just from Daryl Gabbard and others?
Right.
62, Mount Vernon. Four young people encountered a Sasquatch in a parked car. The creature growled ferociously, scaring them into hysterics. One man has reported his cow being attacked by something in the night. Whatever it was lacerated the animal's face and literally tore off its ears. The incident occurred in his backyard, very close to his house.
Within 1 mile of the cave known as Panther Rock, a family lives that had been here for many years. The man is a true outdoorsman. He knows the woods, he knows the animals, he knows what they can do. One afternoon, they heard a disturbance outside. They looked, and one of their cows had burst through a gate and was coming to the house. As they looked, the cow's head was covered in blood. Both its ears had been ripped off. There was nothing left, it's just a little stub where this cow's ears had been. Its eye had been ripped out. They found out that it was protecting a calf that it had just had. And yet something had attacked it and done all this damage. No one is really sure what did this, but this happened within a mile or so of the cave known as Panther Rock. This is another real mystery for the Fraser Land.
The supernatural area known as Panther Rock has long been a part of Kentucky lore. The reality team prepares to spend the night in this mysterious area.
Behind me is the cave known as Panther Rock. Myself and three others were camping one night above this cave. 3 a.m., I was awakened suddenly by someone beating me in the back, screaming, "Look, look, look." I rolled over and looked, and down from the cave, there was a blue-white light. It was a strange light. The intensity was odd. It lit up the tree lines. It lit up everything. Suddenly, it just went off, as if you had thrown a wall switch. We just sat there. There was no smell. There was no sounds. There was no nothing. We'll never know what that light was, but it has been reported before in different areas of the world. To my left is a tree. It's a rather large tree. Some time ago, the owner of this property came here and noticed something rather unusual about this tree. Below this tree were clippings covering the ground. They had been clipped from the edges of this tree. They had been cut in half, almost all of them, with a precision. And that's where it becomes bizarre. What can cut small little pieces of a branch down the middle and do a large volume of them? Nobody knows, but it apparently looks like the tree is dead now. Possibly whatever did this killed the tree. As we stand here in the middle of the Fraser land at this beautiful place known as Panther Rock, we have to realize that within the Serenity, many strange things occur. The Bigfoot, the cats, the tracks, the sounds. Here we are in the Fraser land.
The property at Panther Rock has been handed down for many generations. The owner of the property, Daryl Gabbard, and his family have had experiences of their own in their historic backyard.
When I married Ann, came into the family, they immediately brought me over to look at Panther Rock. And it's a very interesting place, so I began to read about it and ask people about it. And I've learned a lot of folklore and a lot of tales about the place, and it's just an interesting place. One of the tales is how it got its name. According to folklore, there was a chief Indian in this area back when it was beginning to be settled that terrorized everyone in the neighborhood. Behind me, almost directly behind me, a fellow lived in a log cabin. And one night during a terrible rainstorm, he heard a scream, several screams in the direction of the cave. On awakening the next morning, he went down to the cave to see if he could see what the problem was. And there lay a man that had been killed by a panther, obviously, cat scratches and so forth. And it was that Indian chief that had terrorized the whole neighborhood. When he realized what had happened, he ran all the way to Harrodsburg, the nearest settlement, and told the good news to everybody that would listen. Several years ago, I began to notice that each night my dogs would bark and start barking really hard and run towards the back fence of my house. I went out on my back porch and one night and listened, and there was a strange sound, and I could tell that it was coming down the ridge and by a barn that I have down below my house, about a quarter of a mile below my house. And this was not like any animal that I had ever heard. I assumed that it was some kind of cat, bobcat or a panther or whatever, but I never did find out exactly what it was. But every few nights the same thing would happen for quite a while, and it was a mystery to me, and I know that some of my neighbors have heard similar things. One old hunter that was in the area many years ago told me about being out coon hunting and hearing sounds like that, and his dogs all coming and cowering around him because of their fear of this animal. And the feeling that he had as he went home of something following and watching, and everybody being afraid till they got to their house.
As we beheld the mouth of the cave at Panther Rock, we were instantly taken aback by how much it looked like a cenote, which in South America is the cave opening or dwelling where a shaman enters the underworld. Could it be that this symbolized the underworld to the Amerindians that had come across this very place? Could this be a catalyst for the activity in the Fraser land? We have heard the story of the great chief who was killed by a panther, but is there more?
We're standing deep in the Fraser Land, in the vicinity of the cave known as Panther Rock. We came here to investigate the numerous mysterious events associated with the area around this cave. We're going to be out here tonight. We're going to be listening. We're going to be watching. And our purpose is to be here when something happens. And just maybe, and hopefully, that event will be an up-close and in-person meeting with the creature known as Bigfoot.
Among other techniques, knocking has been known to attract the Bigfoot, who is known to communicate by knocking trees, transmitting their location to family members. Team member Tony Gerard demonstrates. Of a recent Bigfoot sighting in the area.
couple of them ran back to the tree. So he went back there, and he shined like a light up there, and he saw this thing sitting up in the branches, like one hand on the trunk and a leg hanging down, and like red eye shine.
Right.
And he could even see canines.
Yeah.
And he said it was not a bear. He climbed down from the tree and stood at the base of the tree on two legs. And he said it like lifted up its nose like it was winding him, and then it like walked off.
Could there be a link between the Howdy and the Bigfoot sightings? We turn to Jeff Waldridge, a local paranormal investigator, for more background.
I'm here with Jeff Waldridge. Jeff is a paranormal investigator, well-known one here in Anderson County, Lawrenceburg. For years, there's been a story here in Anderson County in an area known as Cedar Brook. It's a tale of a creature they call the Cedar Brook Howdy. No one is really sure how this creature got this name, but the tales have gone on for many years and are extremely interesting.
From what I've gathered, it's always been a massive creature, about a little bit taller than a man. I would say probably 6'5", 7 foot tall, but it's massive. It's a really massive creature, very muscular. And the reason they really got that it's, you know, massive, muscular, strong creature, there was a story that there was this boy down there with his girlfriend, and they had pulled down to Cedar Brook in the little pull-off there to park and do what teenagers do. And from what he said, they started hearing rustling around in the weeds behind them. Something came up and started tearing into his car pretty deep. When he got back out of there, he saw three huge claw marks, a three clawed creature had clawed into his car pretty deeply. He had showed this around town several times. I never got the chance to see it, but I knew several people that did, and they said they were really deep scratches.
So, like a reptilian type claw mark?
Yeah, more of, I would say, not really a talon, more of a strong claw, a really deep claw. They said, you know, probably 2 inches each claw was something of that nature.
Okay.
And they always say that it has red glowing eyes and that it's white hair, light-colored hair. From the ones that have caught glimpses of it and things, it's not short-haired, it's more of a long hair.
The red eyes seems to be a really predominant aspect of this creature.
From everything that I've heard, they're bright, they glow. In the dark, which it's very dark on Cedar Brook with the trees and everything, from everything that I've heard, that they will glow in the dark, so they are very luminescent.
At times there's been reports in the Bigfoot community of Bigfoot sightings with red eyes. So this sounds like possible a Bigfoot connection. Do you think that these individuals could possibly be seeing a Bigfoot, or is this some other type of creature?
I think that it could be kind of misinterpreted, and it could be a Sasquatch or a Bigfoot, but honestly, it may be another creature that's out there. From everything that I've heard, it really don't sound like your typical Bigfoot, you know, as far as the aggressiveness goes. Usually, from what I've heard, Bigfoots are very territorial, but this creature sounds like it's very aggressive, and if you get into where it's at, it would actively attack you.
So many stories. And once again, we will just have to stop and wonder, is all this somehow connected to the cave known as Panther Rock? Maybe we'll never know, and then maybe tomorrow, maybe we will.
A new sighting has just been phoned in to the team. This amazing account has never been heard before. It was May of 1973. Just before sunset, an almost commonplace theme with Bigfoot sightings, this time on Hammond Creek Road, where Bruce Young was driving with a friend. They stopped to witness an enormous, hairy creature traverse the ridge above them for almost 30 seconds.
We were just preparing to leave this part of Kentucky when we received a cell phone call. An individual by the name of Bruce Young told us of a Bigfoot sighting here in Anderson County in this area on the Hammonds Creek Road. This report has never been heard before, and you're going to be hearing it for the first time now. In 1973, in May, Bruce Young and a friend were riding along in this area. It was just about sunset, maybe a little bit afterwards, at the twilight time of day. Bruce looked up, and along a ridge line, he saw a very large creature moving along. He took notice of it, stopped his car. He said it was a large creature, 7 to 8 feet tall. He was seeing the side view of this creature. He said he watched it perhaps, well, under 30 seconds was the time of this sighting. He said there was absolutely no doubt in his mind that he saw the creature known as Bigfoot. This is another report from Anderson County. Bruce Young said that it gave him goosebumps and that it somewhat changed his view of nature. He takes a more awareness type of outlook. He notices things. But one thing he knows, he saw this creature as it moved along a ridgeline, and he will never ever forget it. Another report of a Bigfoot sighting from Anderson County, Kentucky.
If there was any question that something mysterious is afoot in the Fraser land, we now turn to the following testimonial, which in this team's experience is one of the most credible and fascinating Bigfoot eyewitness accounts on record.
My name's Lynn Hutton. I live in Anderson County in Kentucky. I've lived here most of my life. I'm 57 years old. I was deer hunting with my son. He was 8 years old at the time. I was bow hunting. I had coveralls on. I did actually illegally have a pistol under my coveralls, but I don't like to go to the woods without one. And for many reasons, and this story is about one of those. Anyway, it got close to being dark, and I told my son, I said, we better get back to my truck before it gets too dark to, you know, see to get back. All of a sudden, about 20 feet from us, if there's no other word to call it, a Bigfoot stepped out. And I had taken my son and kind of pushed him back behind me to the side. And by that time, I realized I better get my gun out. And when I got back to my truck, we got in the truck, we left, and I haven't been back.
Could you tell us anything about its face? You looked at its face.
Its face was just same as its whole body, just long hair. You could make out the eyes. But and the mouth, but the nose not so much. The hair was just real long all over it. It was super long hair.
How many inches maybe on the hair?
On the hair? Oh, at least a foot. At least a foot long.
And when this creature walked out of those cedars, it was looking at you, and then you say it just stepped backwards and kept, was it still looking at you?
Yeah, it never took its eyes off of us. Never, not once. It stepped right back into the cedars just the same way. It stepped out, we looked at each other, stood there a second or two, and it stepped right back, just like that.
Did you smell anything?
No, I did. I was so scared, I didn't notice a smell. There could have been, I'm not going to say, but I did not notice any smell. My son, I asked him, he does not remember any smell. Of course, him being 8 years old, it didn't scare him as much as it did me, because he didn't know what it was. He didn't have an idea of what it was. I knew what it was as soon as I saw it. It had to be. It just couldn't have been nothing else. It was massive. I mean, it's just huge. It scared me so bad that I'll remember it the rest of my life. I will never forget that.
You obviously think that this is a real animal. You don't think this is anything otherworldly. You think this is a disappeared species or a species that we're not aware of.
Yeah, what have you thought about that?
I really do not know. I really can't say one way or the other. I've talked to one friend of mine. He thinks that they're from another dimension. And I'm not going to say that's impossible. I'm not going to say it's not possible that they're from another world. I don't know. I don't know where they come from. I just don't have any idea. I just know what I saw. Huh?
What emotion did you feel at the time?
Fear. surprise at first, when I first saw it, and when I realized exactly what it was, then the fear factor set in. I was really, really scared.
Did you have any perception of what it was feeling?
Caution. That's why I think it scared it too.
What would you say to those people that would say to you that you were either hallucinating or that you have misidentified something, for instance, it's a bear?
Well, no, it was real. It was real. I'm 57 years old, been laughed at about a lot of things. I'm still here. They can laugh at me all they want. I will walk into any church and put my hand on a stack of Bibles and swear to God of what I saw. It was real.
I'm standing here with Tony Girard. Tony joined the team last evening as we ventured back to the cave known as Panther Rock. Tony is a naturalist, a biology professor. We're really pleased to have him with us. And Tony, tell us a little bit about yourself, a little background, some of your thoughts.
Well, I'm a biology teacher by profession, and ever since I was a kid, I've always been interested in natural phenomena. I love a nature mystery, and you know, Bigfoot is a great mystery, and
right.
Nice to be back in this end of Kentucky in some beautiful country. I've always been interested in the Bigfoot phenomena, and I never really much bought into anything like that outside the Pacific Northwest until I talked to Lynn Hutton. And I was really taken aback at the validity of his sighting. In
exactly.
My and I did
yes.
not know what to make of that. Because it's hard to buy into a large unknown primate in North America.
Correct.
There are a whole lot of things that I see as problems there. You know, in 300 gun-toting years of American history, we don't have a body. There's a real lack of historic evidence from the 18th century. You know, if there are Bigfoots in Kentucky, how come we don't
have
all kind of 18th century accounts of it?
Correct, right.
And then you run into somebody like Lynn, and I don't know what to do with that. It's my thought that, you know, we need monsters, we need something mysterious out there. You know, it's the Bigfoot phenomena that interest me the most, because there's actually some physical evidence there that seems very legitimate. Dermal ridges on really good footprint cast, hair that's primate apparently that doesn't match known primates. I mean, people that are that work with that actually have what they consider these are the characteristics of a Bigfoot hair. I don't know. I would love to have just a large undiscovered primate in the woods of North America. I think that would be wonderful. I find that so hard to accept. But I also, in talking with people like Lynn and other very believable witnesses, I can't just say, well, oh, they were mistaken, they were hallucinating, they, you know, or they're lying. I don't know what to do with it. My jury is still out.
We came here to Central Kentucky into the Fraser land in Anderson County to investigate an area around the cave known as Panther Rock. Numerous reports, various type incidents. We've spoken to individuals who've had these events occur to them, affect their lives. Very believable individuals. We've looked into these matters, we've thought on them, and we all agree on one thing. They need to be looked at more. Scientists need to open their eyes and their ears, listen and think openly, as well as everyone, about these type of events. In the future, let's hope that we look into things of this nature. These mysteries abound. They're out there. And what do we know about them? Very little. And how can we ever know about them if we don't investigate them? Kentucky's a beautiful place. Anderson County has wonderful people. We've enjoyed our investigation. We hope to come back someday and look even further, as everyone should do. We want to thank everyone, and we hope to see you again.
In the end, it might not matter who or what the Bigfoot is, or whether it is real or not, whether we obtain scientific proof or not. What might matter most is how these experiences affect the individuals involved in them. Maybe some secrets are not supposed to be revealed or understood by man, and perhaps Panther Rock is one of them.
I will walk into any church and put my hand on a stack of Bibles and swear to God of what I saw. It was real.